Welcome everyone to our September meeting. We've had one on Monday and this is the Friday lunchtime one. So it is just me again, Deborah Thompson. Rick unfortunately is pretty busy and so he isn't here. It's just me, so I am in control apparently. If you can't hear me, we are in trouble, but please check your sound. If I'm too loud, let me know. So the sound is through the computer and everyone is on mute so that everyone's background noise doesn't sort of disrupt us. During the presentation, for all of you people who, or you know, for all of the people who haven't been here before, I will stop for questions because it's only me. I won't actually read them until I get to the question mark. So, please type them in, and you can type them in any time, and I will read them as soon as I get to a question mark. So everyone is on mute. You should have a control panel, and depending on whether you're on Mac or Windows, you will have the questions and the chat. On the Mac version, the questions and the chat are separate, so please use the questions. Again, because it's only me, I'll only be looking at the questions. If you're on the Windows, it's questions slash chat, so it's just the one to use. Now, type it in and you can send it to the organizer, which I am the organizer. And then, as I said, when I come to the part, I will read it and hopefully I will be able to give you a reasonable answer. So our agenda today for our September meeting, we're talking about the cloud and bookkeeping, different types of cloud accounting that seem to be coming out there in the marketplace. We're going to have a look at MYOB's next stage. We're going to have a look at the break-even analysis, the payslips that Fair Work is saying we should be giving to our employees. We're going to have a look at civil claims, the transitional registration, what's left, some workplace myths, and the monthly questions. So if you have your September newsletter, everything I'm talking about today is in, or actually the August newsletter. This is a September meeting, but we're talking about the August newsletter. So everything is in the August newsletter, and it does have obviously more details than my slides. The cloud and the bookkeeper. So I don't know if you have been keeping up, but there has been some talk and chatter on the internet and at conferences and things that some people think, whoever those some people, the mysterious they think that the cloud will replace us, that the cloud is magic and it does everything. And so bookkeepers won't be needed. And it has been an ongoing conversation for the last sort of 3 months. And we are very much saying, I don't think so. Well, I'm very much saying that, I don't think so. Because when you think of the cloud or the bank feeds that are coming through with this cloud accounting solutions, it's just like a box of transactions that you would get from somebody, you know, a shoebox who doesn't do anything. It's all very well to get it electronically, but somebody's got to decide what those transactions are for. Plus, let's be honest, we do so much more than just say, okay, you've spent $5 on milk, I'll put that to staff amenities. I mean, how is any cloud situation or solution going to know when you have an employee, whether they've had overtime, whether they've had annual leave, whether they've had sick leave, whether they've had personal leave, what who's going to tell them that? And it's still going to take a bookkeeper to sort those sorts of things out. Now, this is another thing with change. None of us like change, but we definitely are in a time of very big changes to our industry, just generally, the cloud is making a big inroads. It is the hot topic. Everybody's got devices that they want their solutions to work on. So it is a time of change. None of us like change. We like to be able to do the things that we've done and just keep doing them. But this change is inevitable, and how will we adapt? And that's the thing really that we've got to worry ourselves about, not whether bookkeeping will be finished or not finished. How are we going to adapt to these changes? New technology is going to be good for us. It challenges us. It keeps at least interesting. You know, if you've always, you know, I've done data entry for 20 years, I'm sick of doing it. Well, this cloud computing is going to give us some other things to learn and to keep us interested in. And if we don't learn it, our clients might learn it, and, you know, ahead of us. And then what does that make us look like? Or what does that do to our business? And I guess the main thing is to look and see what we're going to have to change in our business to keep working in this cloud solution. So I am encouraging you, and ICB is encouraging you to embrace the cloud. Doesn't mean all of your clients have to be on the cloud. It means that perhaps you have look at one area and you think, oh, I really like the way that works. That's how I'm going to work in the cloud, or that's how I want my clients to work in the cloud. You're still going to have to be the ones, even with bank feeds, you're going to have to be the ones to allocate transactions. Yes, what will happen is that the first month, say you'll allocate or you'll set up recurring transactions for maybe half the transactions, and then the next month you're going to be working again with that client, and half of the transactions will come in, and you'll be able to just very quickly click, click, click. For example, I was at the MYOB conference. And Deb Anderson, a longtime certified consultant, was saying that she had been working with this client on live accounts for about 4 months, and she was down to it taking about 7 minutes to do the client's monthly, you know, information, because she has over the months set up all the rules and things were happening pretty automatically. But that also leads us to the point that we have to think about how we're going to charge, because you have got smarter and because you are using the technology doesn't necessarily mean that your income should go down. So again, it's about thinking about your business. Are you going to charge per task, not the time that it actually takes to do it? You're also going to have to claim a check all the claims are legitimate. So we've still got clients that we know we need to see the invoices to actually say this is an invoice that can be claimed. We're going to be the ones who set up the rules for these bank feeds coming in, so that if it comes from Ideal Electrics, it's going into purchases if you're working for an electrician. However, you're still going to have to look at that and see that each one of those invoices is actually for purchases and not when he's decided to renovate his house. The cloud stroke internet, they're really they each substitute their words. You know, the cloud is the internet and the internet is working in the cloud. And it's really about better interaction, not just sort of replacing us. Benefits of the cloud. Well, there's lots of benefits. There's also lots of interesting things. If we're using internet banking, we're using cloud computing, and I don't know about you, but I love internet banking. It's wonderful to be able to set up my banking so that it happens on the day that I want it to. I've just got to make sure the money's there. The important thing, perhaps, is a fast and reliable internet connection. So again, if you're in the big cities, Melbourne and Sydney, you will probably have a reasonably reliable and fast internet connection. If, however, you're around Australia in regional areas, like I am in regional Australia, even though it is, I think, the sixth largest city on the Gold Coast, our internet is not that good. We're all hanging out for the NBN. And if you're in an older area and within 5 kilometres of a telephone exchange, then you can get reasonable internet. If you're anywhere else, your internet's not that wonderful, even if you've paid $1 million for your house. The other benefit of the cloud is that most of the solutions give you the facility to be multi-user. So the owner, the bookkeeper, the accountant can all get immediate access. You don't have to be sending disks and USBs and all that to get each one of us, the owner, the bookkeeper, and the accountant, into the data file. There are productivity gains. It cuts down on your data entry. Again, if I take Deb Anderson's situation, where over 3 months she's set up the rules as she's come across more transactions, so that after 4 months, 6 months, I guess it depends on how many things there are to enter, her data entry is cut down because so many of the rules are already set and defined. It's a lot more real-time accounting rather than historic, because normally when we go in as contract bookkeepers, we're going in definitely after the fact. And so we're always dealing in historic accounting. In the old days, when we had to wait for a bank statement to arrive, we were in the next month before we got the bank statement. So we're always dealing with historic. So it's become the benefits of the cloud becomes more real-time accounting. It's convenient and flexible. If you're working from home, you can sit in your jammies at 11 o'clock at night and, be looking at your clients' accounts and doing work on them. However, I actually do think that could be a bit of a trap, because knowing what we're all like, we probably will end up working at 11 o'clock at night instead of actually having a life. So do remember to have a life in there as well. It's collaborative, which again is allowing the accountant, the owner, and the bookkeeper all to be looking at the information and all to be, talking about it and using it. Most of the solutions, as I said, are multi-user. You get so many people that you can log in to the data file at any one time. There's reduced costs on infrastructure. You don't have to have the big computer and the big, terminal server, so that you can have an office with five people working on it. You don't have to have all of that, because if you have the reliable internet connection, you can have it up in the cloud and you can be working on it that way. The upgrades are automatic, so what will happen is you'll go to bed at night and you wake up the next morning and you have a new version of the software, because they have a centralized place to upgrade it. You don't have to be putting in disks and what have you. That, of course, frightens me a little bit. I have been working with software for a very long time, and I remember when upgrades don't always work. But I'm sure that's not going to happen to us in the future. And also, with some of the solutions, it doesn't matter whether you're on a Mac or whether you're on a PC or you're on a Unix machine or whatever you're using. Doesn't have a bearing. So again, that's infrastructure. You don't have to upgrade all the time. So let's talk about some of these new things that we have to get our head around in the introduction to the cloud. The first one is that there is two ways of buying, if you like, or subscribing to your software. And certainly most of the software developers are looking for subscription-based. They want that ongoing income. So the first one is software as a service. Now that is definitely browser-based. So I won't say any more about that. I'll get on a bit further. The next one is software plus service. And that's where you normally have the software on your machine, plus you might be working in the cloud. So there's three main implementations that people seem to be using, that everybody seems to the choices that we're making. And I guess, I don't know whether one will become the more dominant than the other. The first one is browser-based, and the examples that I have of that are MYOB Live Accounts, Reckons Cashbook Online, Xero, Sasu. They are all browser-based solutions, and I'll come back to what that means in a minute. ASP hosted, which is terminal server type, and ASP stands for Application Service Provider. So it's like ISP, except it's got the A. And then the third one is synced desktops. Now, I've got MYOB account right there, but I'm sure that Reckon also has a product. I just don't know which of the Reckon products that is. But Via might be able to tell me which is the Reckon product. So looking at the implementations, the browser-based, the MYOB Live Accounts, the Reckon Cashbook Online, the Xero Sasu. Nothing is on your local machine. You access the software through a web browser. So you don't have the software on your machine. So therefore, you have to have an internet connection to be working on the software. Typically, also, you can't do a backup. The software developers, they provide redundancies and what have you. I do know, for example, I do know that someone is working on a Xero or a backup that they would be able to do with Xero, but it isn't around as yet. The other thing is, again, because they are subscription-based, if you decide to stop paying or your client decides to stop paying, what do you do? Now, you need to make sure, and it is something that you really do need to think about, you need to make sure you can get the data out. So you can't stop paying until you've got the data out. And that data, getting it out, you might just be exporting it into Excel. I know I was talking, because I've done this now, this is my fourth one. So someone was saying that what they've done is they just printed reports and they're going to keep those. Because remember, you have to keep it for 7 years. Even if you decide not to be in business, you're supposed to be keeping records. So do think about what you're going to do or what you're going to recommend to your clients, that if they want to stop paying, how are they getting the information? Now, the ASP hosted terminal server type, and as I said, I'm pretty sure it's application service provider is what the ASP stands for. We Googled it, so it must be right. This is like, I always think back of when, you know, big companies were the only ones who had computers. And I guess I think of Qantas, that Qantas had a central machine and all everybody dialed into that machine. So this hosted type service is where you are getting big enough that you don't want to deal with all the infrastructure, and so you host it out on somebody else's infrastructure and everybody dials into that and they don't know that they're not dialing into your office. For example, I know for a fact that the Gold Coast City Council and Coolangatta Airport do exactly that, because I know who the ASP provider is. So their software, they still have to buy the software. They put that on the hosted machines and people have a remote desktop, or they would have it set up so that it doesn't look like you're dialing into them. But it is in fact a remote desktop connection. Again, this is internet based, but you would be able to do backups, because it's just like having the server on your own machine, except that you've got it hosted somewhere else bigger that can do all the things that you need it to do. And again, you need to make sure that you've got all your information backed up so that you can get to it when you need to. And then the third one is the synced desktop. And as I said, I've got MYOB account right live, where you're normally working on the internet. So the data is in the cloud and it is up there. But what it is doing, it is syncing. It is sending the information down to a hidden file on your desktop and putting that information so that you actually have a copy of the data file on your machine or whoever's machine you want it to be on. And so if the internet isn't working, or if for whatever reason, you can check the file out of the internet, work on your machine, and then when you want to put it back into the internet. For example, David Wilson, I think it was, gave the example that if he was going on a plane to Perth, but he wanted to do some work on his data file. So before he got on the plane, he would check out the data file. Now that means nobody else can put information into that data file. They can go in, they can get reports, it's read only. So he works at it on the plane, and then when he gets to Perth, he checks it back in and everybody else can see what he's done, and now they can put information in. So you can have it either for that sort of scenario, or if you wanted to do, I don't know, whatever you wanted to do that you didn't want anybody else to be touching it. Or, for example, if you perhaps live in regional Australia and your internet is a bit dodgy, you could actually check the file out, work on it for 3 hours, and then check it back in so that then everybody can get to it. So I think it is a really good combination. If your internet is a bit of a worry. So issues that I think, again, we all have to start thinking about, and how we're going to approach our clients, and what sort of information or advice we're going to give them. So if you're in the browser-based solution, you're not going to be able to back up, or currently you can't back up, and the provider, the service provider, does all those redundancies. If you're using the synced desktop solution, then you can take point-in-time copies, and that's really good. So, for example, if you're using the MYOB account right live, you will be able, if you've done the BAS and you've put all the information, you will be able to take a backup and keep that on your machine, so that you can go back to that point in time if there's any queries. There are other things that you need to think about, and that is ownership of the data file. Who owns what? For example, a lot of the service providers are encouraging you to be the one who subscribes to them, and you get a commission and on-sell it to your clients. Now that's fine and it's lovely and it's very nice for us to make a little bit of money. However, make sure that, you know, have you got the money from the client if you have to have a 12-month subscription? Because you might find if the client decides they don't want to pay, you might still be up for the 12 months. So it is worth getting all that straight in your mind before you, again, as you approach your client, have that information so that you can tell them what your business model is. And again, what happens if you stop paying? I know that Xero in different ones can sometimes give you a couple of months free access. So again, if you had that money from your client, then you would be able to say, okay, well, at least if they decide to stop paying, I've got 2 months, because I've had that 2 months from them, I've got 2 months to then make sure I've got all the information and stop the subscription. I do know some others who have gone very heavily into Xero, who what they're doing in June is they are giving their clients an invoice for 12 months subscription and saying if you want a tax deduction, or, you know, or maybe they give them 1 month free. So there's those sorts of things that are going to change our business model. How are we going to work with the cloud? ICB is also doing some webinars presented by Heather Smith about the cloud to give you a little bit more information about the cloud so that you can get all that together. Now, the first one has already happened, the introduction to the cloud. But if you're an ICB member, you can log on to the website, go in to book in to the other ones, and you will actually find a link and a password to get you so that you can listen to that first webinar, which was great. I really enjoyed it. So this is our first stop for questions. Has anyone got any questions that they would like me to answer? I will just have a mouthful of drink while I'm waiting. So please, if you do have questions, just type it in as you think of them. And then when I get to one of these little question marks, I will read it. Just make sure that you write it into the questions area. Okay, so not at the moment, but please, as I said, if you do have questions, you guys might know all about the cloud and I'm happy to learn. Okay, so MYOB, the next stage is here. So it's all happening. And I want to perhaps make an effort to get you to think about the word live, because I don't want you to get confused about where MYOB are using the word live a lot. So, for example, one product is MYOB Live Accounts, and the other product is MYOB AccountWrite Live. So just think about those for the second. So the live accounts does invoices, tracks expenses, pays employees, manages your GST, but it's all online. It's a browser-based solution, $25 a month. And it's really cool. I thought it looked really good with the employees. It's meant for companies that are small and that are perhaps at this moment not computerized. So it's not meant for a company with 10 employees and complex categories and pay rates and all that sort of thing. It is meant for simple companies that currently perhaps might still be using a spreadsheet to do their books. But just again, remember that it's MYOB Live Accounts. And the reason that I say that is because I think when clients come to us and they go, "Oh, yeah, I've got MYOB Live," you're going to have to make sure, did you buy a box of software or what did, how did you get it? Because I think the word live is going to cause a bit of confusion. ICB is encouraging you to look at the MYOB AccountWrite 2012, because I think it's really important to. We've been holding off and holding off with the product, but I think it's important for us to make sure that we get our heads around the software. It is time. You'll see that in the newsletter, ICB are recommending that you have a look at relevant clients who you could upgrade. And I think it's a really good important for us to get using the software and to be getting to know it and to know its idiosyncrasies and what we've got to do. However, of course, if you have got clients with Empowered or Premier, multi-currency, if they're using ODBC, those guys still can't upgrade, but you certainly can upgrade other people. And I would encourage you to start, perhaps upgrading a couple of people so that you can learn about the product and make sure that you understand what's happening to it. So, MYOB AccountWrite 2012 is going to turn in to MYOB AccountWrite Live. So it's the AccountWrite Live that becomes a solution that can be in the cloud or on your desktop. So you can still work exactly as you are now in the on your machine and don't have to be in the cloud. But if you want to, you are able with the subscription to then have one data file in the cloud. And that immediately gives you some advantages. So, for example, the MYOB AccountWrite Right Live is going to be a synchronized desktop solution. It's currently in pilot. I have, in fact, been playing with it this morning. The software is on your machine, plus it's in the cloud. The data file, you have the choice of working offline or online, whichever you would prefer. You can check out the data file out of the cloud, and that means only you can work on it, and then you can check it back in when you want other people to be working on it. So it is synchronized every 20 minutes. So every 20 minutes, any changes that have happened synchronize back to your desktop machine, and that is in a hidden place. I guess you only need it if something happens to your data file. You are able to take point of time backups. It becomes immediately multi-user. You can get five users. So whether you've got a standard business basics or AccountRight Plus, you will be able to have five users immediately working up in the cloud. You do have secure backup offsite, and if, for example, you currently have a client, which I have, with 10 data files, they are able to upgrade the 10 data files, but please note they can only put one in the cloud for their subscription. They are going to have to pay another subscription. It is cheaper, and I will let MYOB give you all those pricing and what have you when that comes out. But it will be cheaper, but it will have to be another subscription if you want another account, another data file in the cloud. If you've got, as I said, five data files, one can be in the cloud for the subscription you've got, and the four can be on your machine without a problem. If you don't want to be in the cloud, you don't have to be. You don't have to have any in the cloud, but it will be available from your subscription. And if you have got, you're on 19, or you've come from version 18, you had five data files, you've upgraded five data files to 19, you then upgrade them to the MYOB AccountRight Live product, you can still have your five data files upgraded. That is not going to be an issue at all. So, hopefully I have explained that. So I have got a question mark. If anyone has got so Tracy asked me about Empowered. As far as I know, I have no information that tells me when the Empowered. It certainly was talk at the MYOB conference, but they haven't yet come up with the date, what they're doing. And this time I will say that they are being very cautious. They are being much more cautious with this product, the AccountRight Live product, being released to market. We have been, there's quite a few of us who have been testing it for, I would think since May, we have been testing it. Actually, it might have even been since April. We've been testing it so that it is a much more solid program. When it is released, and I believe they're thinking of the end of October, the beginning of November, so far, but there's no official dates about when it will be released. Now, as far as AccountRight 2012, I believe they're already calling it 2012. I didn't think they were, but apparently they are already. That if you put the compliance update and everything on that, it is being called AccountRight 2012. But yeah. Avril, your question about whether it's going to be both Mac and PC. Don't see it happening. There is a new version of Account Edge coming out. I think that's in January or the first quarter next year. They're talking about a new Mac version coming out. But I don't see them going back to Mac and PC. What I see the solution, and this is only me thinking further on of what I have seen happen, I assume that what they'll be able to do, the one that's in the cloud, you will be able to use again, probably through the web or something like that, that it'll be able to be used on both Mac and PC. But you do need the partner edition if you want to use the Mac version on your PC. And yeah, it isn't something I'm very happy about because I am a Mac girl. But we have to work with what we've got, I think. So, no more questions or no more answers, no more questions. So, I will move on. Now, in the newsletter, there was an article about the break-even analysis. So, I would recommend that you go in and have a look in the newsletter. It's also on the website, and it was from an article from ICB UK. Now, break-even analysis is a great thing to do. I often wonder how many of my clients want it, and the truth is that not many of my clients want it. They just want to see if there's money in the bank. They must be doing all right if they've got money in the bank. But of course, in these tough times, it can be a very useful thing to actually make them think about it. But that's why I think clients don't always want to think about it. But you will be able to download it off the ICB website. There is an Excel spreadsheet and the information in the article. So fixed costs, those costs are incurred, which you can't do anything about. You're going to have to pay them no matter what. Rent being the most obvious one, salaries, rates, those sorts of things, they're just there and you just have to find the money to pay them. Variable costs, of course, are costs that tend to vary depending on if you're in manufacturing, what volume you're doing. They might go up because you have to have overtime for people to work, longer to pack or what have you. So your variable costs can go up and down, and perhaps they might be some things that you can control. Contribution in the break-even analysis is the value of sales less your variable costs. So that gives you your contribution. And then your break-even point, the point where all of the expenses as against all of the income, you're not going to make a profit or a loss. It's just going to be even. So in the example in the newsletter, there was a business for sale. It was turning over $645,000. It had a net profit of $72,000. There were direct materials, direct labor, production, overhead, selling, distribution, administration. Now, all of the administration is a fixed cost. They decided that half the selling and distribution was fixed and half was variable, and about the same with the production overheads. About half were fixed and half were variable. And they looked at the turnover that they made 8,000 pool cues. So when they went in and did the analysis, having set up what the variable costs were and having set up what the fixed costs were, they had a look to see what would happen to the business if they only made 6,000 pool cues or they made 10,000 pool cues. Now, making 25% less of what they were selling had a huge impact on their net profit because their fixed costs were rather high. And so this can be a great tool for you if your clients are looking at what they're doing and are having a bit of concern about what their volume were. Obviously, you are able to do it for other businesses, but this is a manufacturing style thing. So you can also then do a graph and work out where your break-even point is and what happens if, there's a downturn and you only make this so many, you only make 6,000, or whether all of a sudden you get to sell 10,000 pool cues. So this is the document is available from the newsletter and from the ICB website, and this is sort of a spreadsheet that you're able to use for your clients. So it is a service that you are able to provide for your clients. Okay, have I got any questions? No, but I will give you a moment. Okay, I will move on then. As I said, it is in the newsletter. Now, Fair Work and the payslip. You know that over the last few months we've been saying don't worry about the superannuation being told on the payslips. It hasn't become law yet. Hang on, don't panic, sort of thing. Well, it has become law. The fact that you have to tell your employees when you intend or when you expect to pay the superannuation guarantee amount to the super funds. Now, at the moment, there isn't a start date for it. The law has been passed, but there isn't a start date of when you have to have it on the payslip. And you're going to have to amend the payslips for each payslip, disclosing when you think or when you expect, and I'm sorry about the spelling mistake there, when you expect to pay the super for the employees. Now, as I said, I have done this 4 times now, and we also had the interesting discussion that we're not, as bookkeepers or BAS agents, supposed to be giving superannuation advice. So are we even allowed to tell our clients about amending the payslips? And I sort of think, well, we're allowed to do payroll. I'm assuming that we can do the payslip. And the reality is that we are supposed to pay the SGC by the 28th of July, October, January, April. And I expect that my tendency will be for my clients to go in and put a text box on the payslip that says the superannuation guarantee is expected to pay by the 28th of October if I'm looking at this quarter. Because remember, if you have weekly payslips, you're going to have that on each one of those payslips. It's not just the last one for the month. You are going to have to have that on every payslip. So I imagine every quarter it's going to be another thing added to my BAS when I go and see clients, is to go and change that payslip or to show my clients how to do it. But the reality is they're not probably going to do it. So I will have to remember. And yes, some people felt that because we're not supposed to be giving superannuation advice to our clients, that perhaps it's something we shouldn't be doing. However, I don't know. But certainly in the newsletter, and on the ICB website and on Fair Work, you can have a look at the payslip and all the information that is supposed to be on it. As yet, I also haven't heard from any of the software companies, not that they tell me everything, but I haven't heard any of the software companies on their plans to adjust that. Other things that are in the newsletter that I didn't think would make very interesting slides is the Business Compliance Basic article, which is basically information or website addresses for all the sorts of information that your clients should be looking up for their obligations. So there's web addresses to Fair Work and to the ATO and to payroll tax and to workers' comp and all those sorts of things. And it is a document you can download off the ICB website and give to your clients with all the web addresses that that they should be looking at what their obligations are. Because it's not only, or it's not our responsibility to know all this, it is also their responsibility to look it up. So it is, does give you a sheet that you're able to give to your clients. The other thing is that there has been another guide that ICB has produced, that the volume 2 of the Applying the Code of Conduct, and my understanding it is being sent out to you as we speak. Now, I do know that there are some questions which I will have a look at in a minute. The other thing that's really interesting in the newsletter is that ICB and QuickBooks have done a special pricing thing that if you are a member, you're able to get QuickBooks courses at a great rate. That looks like an absolutely super rate. The first one, the QuickBooks Certificate for Bookkeepers, is a two-day course. And so that $350 is a great price. And then paying your employees with QuickBooks, that is a day course. So if you would like to do that and become a QuickBooks specialist bookkeeper, then you can give Reckon a ring or you can email them. They are holding them in Brisbane, Sydney, Melbourne, Perth, Adelaide, I believe, and the dates and the information is in the newsletter, and have a look at the ICB website. So I will pay attention now. So I'm looking at the questions. Okay, now Julie says, I have a pay regarding salary including super. Please advise a formula to work out same. I did my own, but it did not work when I went to try it. So I'm assuming, Julie, that what you mean is that they've given you like a package deal, or you know, they've given the employee a package deal, and they've said, but this includes super. So I have done that for a client, and I think off the top of my head, and I was terrible, I would have to go and look, but I multiplied it by 109%, I think, and worked it out that way, and then took what that figure was off it and then paid them that as wages. What I perhaps will have to do, Julie, is because it's ages since I've done it, is I will have to have a look, and if you would like to send me an email, I will let you, or if you'd like to send ICB an email so that we've got your email address, I will get back to you with actually the calculation. But I'm sure I just multiplied it or divided it, one of the two, by 109%, and somebody else might have an answer to that. Okay. Via says, QuickBooks already has a payroll preference to allow for super payment date to appear on the payslip. So there you are. QuickBooks already has it if you're using QuickBooks. And I'm assuming, again, this is another advantage of the cloud software, is that that sort of thing can be updated much more quickly in this new version of software than in the old, that it only came out once a year. So Avril is right. She said divide it by 1.09. So there you are, Julie. I know that that's, I've done something like that, but I just couldn't remember off the top of my head, making me think on my feet. Yes, so it seems to be the general consensus. You take the gross figure and divide it by 1.09 to get the gross figure ex super. So I actually did for my client, because it's a figure that changes every month. So I did them up a little Excel spreadsheet. They put it in and then it flows down so that they know then what super and what salary to pay. So, yeah, so everybody seems to be saying 1.09, Julie, which is good. Yes, dividing it by the 109. So there you are. It's nice to know that I sort of had it right. Camellia's saying you have to multiply it by 100 as well. So she's saying amount including super multiplied by 100, then divide by 109. Okay. All right. So what I normally do if to test it in case I've got it, the wrong way around, is I actually have MYB open at the time. I put it in Excel, work it out, and then put it into MYB and see if I came up with the same figure. And if I did, that must be the calculation. Okay, so that's so I hope that helps. But as I said, Julie, if you want, you can email admin@icb.org.au and I will get back to you when I go to my clients and remind myself how I did it, or I will try it. Okay, moving right along. Civil claims. Now, unfortunately, in times that are tough, often we do need to see when people aren't paying us how we're going to get that money. And small claims tribunals, magistrate courts, they are the places that we seem to have to go to. Now, some industries are regulated and there might be tribunals, but and each state has a different dollar limit for, whether you're in the small claims tribunal and the magistrates court, or there's also community justice. So I would recommend, and again, in the ICB newsletter, there is loads of email address, website addresses for each of the states and each of their different courts. Because I looked at the South Australian, not that I'm in South Australia, but I looked at the South Australian, and that's got great information on there about how to do it and what you have to do. So most claims under 10,000, I mean, they can even, have arbitration. Not that you don't go to the magistrates' court for that sort of thing. And small claims is usually less formal. You don't have lawyers and what have you involved. Each state's different, of course, because none of us can do everything the same. We do suggest that you go to the relevant website for your state and download the forms and the information that's going to tell you how much it's going to cost. There is a fee to lodge this. As I said, there's community justice centres for mediation. And if you don't want to do any of that, we also recommend eCollect as a professional collection service. So you can certainly find them on the internet. Unfortunately, it's an area that sometimes we have to go to. So I'll just let me look and see. No more questions. Okay. Now, I was under the impression that this had already happened, but apparently no. The transitional registration, you are still able to register as a transitional BAS agent up to February 2013. So if you're competent, you're reasonable, you're fit and proper, you are eligible to register still as a transitional BAS agent as long as you get in before February 2013. You just need to have two letters from clients or employers or accountants that you've been doing BAS services competently up to 700 hours over the last 2 years. And we have had discussions about, how do they know that you're competent? They don't, but you do need those letters from accountants or clients to say that you've been doing it. The transitional registration, you don't have to finish your cert four. So, and I guess really this just gives all the people who haven't yet finished their cert four time to do it. So you just have to renew. The next time you renew, you have to have done your cert four. Obviously, if you already are a BAS agent, you're already in the system, you guys know what you're doing. But this is only for people who haven't yet done it. Okay, so questions. Julie just asked me about the webinars. We will be coming up to that, Julie, so just hold that thought for the moment. But it's basically we're doing them monthly. Okay, now workplace myths and facts, or yes, a myth. And I do have a client who does this all the time, even though you say, no, you can't do this. The retail industry are a bit rife for it, but you cannot ask a person to come and work for you for nothing just as a trial to see if you like them. If they work for you, then they have to be paid. They're also entitled to the National Employment Standards, and they have to be paid. You're allowed to ask them to, touch type if you're giving them a test at the interview, or if they were being a barista, you're allowed to ask them to make a coffee, but you're not allowed to come and ask them for a to work for a shift and not pay them. And I guess you guys all know that. It's our clients who sort of perhaps conveniently like to forget these things. The next one is about an employee taking annual leave or sick leave before they've worked for you for 12 months. They are entitled to do that. If, for example, you had somebody come and work for you and that maybe they've worked a month, and then they break their leg and they have sick time. Maybe they have a week off because they've broken their leg. They are entitled to be paid for whatever sick leave they have accrued. Obviously, you don't have to pay them for time they haven't yet accrued, but you are supposed to give them sick leave up, pay them up to what they had accrued. The annual leave obviously has to be mutually convenient, but for example, and I know, it's happened to me before where you go for an interview, you start a new job, and you say, but hang on, I already had a holiday booked, and I'm still going to take the holiday sort of thing. So then you again, depending on what they've accrued, you only have to pay them what they have accrued. But they are entitled to receive annual leave and sick leave for the time they have accrued. Then the last one is, can I fire an employee without notice because they're on a trial or a probationary period? And no. You can't, unless they have done something naughty. Serious misconduct is the only way. Obviously, if they're on a fixed term, that they're only working for you for 6 months, well, that's a fixed term, and so they should know their end date anyway. But if they have worked for you less than 12 months, they are entitled to at least a week's notice. You also need to refer to the modern award that you are paying them under, and make sure that the modern award doesn't have any other extra entitlements in it, because the National Employment Standard is where it's the 1 week's notice for under 12 months. But if they're under an award where they get more than that, then you have to give them the more, because remember, you have to do the BOOT, the Better Off Overall test. So they have so you do need to check all the modern awards to make sure that you are giving them all of their entitlements. Okay. Any more questions? No. Maybe I'm too fast for you. I don't give you a chance to type in. Okay. Now, again, you might see in the newsletter, but every month they put a question for us to talk about and see what we think's the right thing. And then they put the answer the next month in. So I think it's really interesting because I like to see what answers they put in. I guess I like the guidance. So in July's newsletter, The question was that you get a new client, you go there, you find out that they've got contractors that have worked for several years for this client. They've worked as contractors, but really they work full time and they can't go and get other work because they're working full time, excuse me. And you tell the owner that really they should be employees. The owner goes to the contractors, well, look, guys, you're going to be employees. And the contractors go, nah, if you're going to make us employees, we're leaving. And so the owner goes, well, don't want that to happen. I will just ignore the advice. And the question was, what should you do? And I think the next screen is really important. You need to ask questions and provide information, but the final decision is up to the business owner. I have a client myself who every 3 months I say to them, I believe these cleaners should be employees. Every quarter, my client says back to me, the accountant says it's all right. And I go, okay. However, it really grates with me, but every quarter I say it, and every quarter they come back with the same comment. So it's their decision. You need to have a look at what the relationship is with these people, and you need to give your client all the information and let them make the decision. If you came to March's ICB conference, you received a manual. In that manual, all this information is there, quite extensively. We went through it at the conference. But we just wanted to bring it back because the questions that we ask or that they put in the newsletter are questions that we're getting through our support line. So you have to look at the contract of service, or whether it's contract of service or contract for service. The contract of service is much more a master-servant type relationship. It's the degree of control. If you're, or if the client is, the owner of the business is saying, you work here, you work this time, you do it this way, this is how you do it, when, where, what you perform, then it is much more a master-servant type relationship. Whereas if it's contract for service and they go, this is the task I want done, do it. And all of the decisions on how it's done, when it's done, what happens, who does it, then it is much more a contractor's type of relationship. So there are four tests, and I do know, of course, that on the internet, on the ATO website, there is that test that you can do it. But you do need to have a look at these things, and you, I guess, give the information. The control again is about, how, when, where. Likely an employee if the owner of the business says how, when, where. Whereas if the contractor can say, oh, well, I'm not turning up today, Deb is, she's going to do it, and you can put somebody else in there to do the job, then it's more likely a contractor. The integration test is, do you advertise? Do you work for other businesses? So obviously, if you're working 40 hours a week, you haven't got time to work for any other businesses. So again, that makes it less likely that you're a contractor. However, there can be situations, and someone was telling me on Tuesday where her son works, he is a builder of some sort. I'm not sure, he's in the building industry, and he works per job for a company as a contractor. And they've been tested and everything, but of course, they have the workers' comp paid, they have the superannuation paid, they have all the Burton and that sort of information paid, but it is a for a time. So it might he might work full time, but it for is for 3 months or 6 months or however long the job takes. And he goes from contract to contract like that, working as a contractor. The results. If the worker is hired for a result, regardless of the hours worked, so you again, it's about the task, and that's actually one area that we need to think about as well, that we are doing a task rather than we're working for the hours. We're achieving a result that we are going in to make sure that the BAS is done, or we're going in to do a month's worth of data processing. It is a result that we're coming away with. So if you are working towards a result, then you are more likely a contractor. And then the risk. So for example, in the situation where Deb was sent in because the person who got the contract wasn't there, if she's made a mess of it, and then who wears that cost of getting it fixed? And if it's the person who got the contract, then again, they're more likely contractors. Whereas if the owner of the business has to pay again to get it fixed, then again, it's more likely an employee-employer relationship. So those are all things to think about. They're information to give your client, but the client is the final decision in that. So this question is in August newsletter. A client who's interested in purchasing a race car, he's the director of an auto recycling business. So they certainly, perhaps match, the business type thing. You could understand the legitimate sort of connection. He wants to use the vehicle for advertising at races and in his business. So the cost of the vehicle, including all the signage, will be around 40,000. There'd be ongoing running costs. Can you claim it for its use in races at the business premises? Running costs. What do you think? Please, everybody, type in those sorts of things, those answers, if you think. For example, I will give you the example that I know about is that I worked with a client and they actually had five companies, but one of the companies was a race team for motorcycles. But that was its own business in its entirety, and it went to obviously the other parts of the business, but it also went to outsiders to get sponsorship. And if races were won, that was shared with the riders and the business because the business funded everything. And the riders had to pay it back, if you like, what they'd funded. So it was, a 60-40 sort of relationship. And therefore, in that case, everything was claimable because it was its own company and that's what its business was, being a race team. On the side of the other businesses who put in the sponsorship, we would put that into the sponsorship account and let the accountant then decide what was doing it. But other people have also said this, that signage is going to be claimable because of advertising. But for example, travel costs that they where they've had that sort of thing, they haven't been able to claim travel costs unless the person was going down to that to do business with clients, not just going to see the racing. The other thing, of course, that I thought might throw different things on this, is this a hobby car? Is this a hobby racing? Because I know that it cost a lot more than $40,000 for the race team that I was involved in. So I'm interested to find what everybody else thinks could be the answers to this. Again, as I said, it would be something that I would be going back to the accountant and asking what would they be putting in. Is there FBT situation on this? Definitely, I for me, I see the signage being claimable, and I don't know about the other costs, so I'm open to everybody else. So if anybody else has got anything else they would like to comment on that, please, because I've got there. Now, I'm just looking at my question, seeing I have my question. I don't know whether that comes up for you guys. Via was saying that she sends an email to the client with our discussion about the client's got the final word on what to do. So she sends an email to the client, a copy to the accountant with concerns, re-employees and contractors with all the links. And I really do think that that's what you've got to do. You need to show that you've given them the information. And again, I have done this with my clients, with the cleaners, that and that's where they had the conversation with the accountant, that the accountant said it was okay. So Avril talking about our racing, she's been inclined to believe that a certain amount should be a tax deductible, but would definitely want to confirm with their accountant. I think, like all of us, it is the place to go. It is the place to make sure that we and the accountant are on the same page, and they are the ones that decide that it's whether it's tax deductible. As I said, there could be, fringe benefit. Maybe the signage would be. So it's always worth the email to the accountant to ask the question. Okay, and so Julie says races, no, not of support to a recycling business. Signage, yes, running costs only if making deliveries of auto parts. So again, they would be questions that you would want to be checking with the accountant. And I agree with you, Julie, about not visiting the races, but someone at one of the meetings said, of course, they have their client says that they are going to see other clients. They're going to see clients of theirs when they go to a race meeting. So, yes, you would want perhaps some instructions from the accountant on what to claim or where to put it, I would think. Okay, so no more questions or no more opinions on that. But as I said, I'm always interested in next month to find out what is going to, what ICB answer are going to put in there. So, speaking of our webinars, I do this every second Friday of the month at Melbourne time, which is 12 noon. And every second Monday. Sometimes the Fridays are first, sometimes the Mondays are first. So this month, Mondays were first, and I believe next month also the Monday will be first. The Monday is at 5 p.m., just to give a different time. And we're also, as I said, we're trying to tape these and be able to put these up so that you are able to listen to them at times that suit you. Also, too, I will mention with the October meetings, I believe that we are on summertime by then. So be aware that, for example, with me, I've got to make sure that I'm there at 11 o'clock because I'm on Queensland and I don't have summertime. So it's noon Melbourne time, whatever that is, on the 12th of October for the Friday. And then it is 5 p.m. Melbourne time on the 8th of October. And I did have a look it up, and I'm pretty sure that the summertime starts on the 7th of October, the Sunday, the day before this meeting. So please just note that, otherwise you will be an hour late. I appreciate all of you listening, and hope you've learnt something or had a good time. And as I said, everything that I've talked about is in the newsletter for August, and so therefore you can have a look at some more detail. Obviously, too, there are loads of links in that newsletter that you're able to investigate more things. If you would like to give us any feedback or questions or what have you, deborah@icb.org.au will get me, admin@icb.org.au if you have, you know, a support question. And on that happy note, oh, I'm early today. Thank you very much. And I am here if you have got questions. Oh, and there are questions. Via says, with the employee contractor topic, some of my clients' accountants have recently changed their mind and are now acting on it. And that's interesting, because accountants sometimes don't do much about it until we perhaps keep pressuring it. Yeah, so that is interesting. I still think that we do have to keep telling the accountants what we think, and then often they will work on it. So thanks to everybody. And as I said, I will stay here for everybody to, if I can answer any questions, I am absolutely happy to. And thank you for coming. Please do come again next month. And I might just finish my recording, but as I said, I'll still stay on.